project or make representations. So to give you a feel for the numbers, out of that 383.90, I've been advised that in August there were 49 occasions where people have made representations to the FPN that's been issued. Very broadly, out of those, round about 60% of those are cases where we uphold the issuing of the FPN. Round about 40% of those, so it's a relatively small number, we listen to the representation put forward, and for good reason, the FPN will be cancelled or written off. Two of the examples where that often happens is sometimes it might be that an FPN has been issued and it will be a person who are they under the age of consent, whether they are born below 16. So sometimes it might be that a minor has been accidentally issued with an FPN, and clearly then that would be cancelled. And sometimes we have cases where people have proven that for medical reasons, such as mental capacity or reasons, that obviously just you know what we're doing when it happens. So it's just bearing in mind then. We talked about it and called it all the genuine reasons why FPNs will be repealed. And then I think also for completeness out of those, members will be aware that all the enforcement interactions, there's the body-worn cameras, so very often, we do make the offer that if people want to come in and view the footage of the cameras, I think we've had about four occasions where people are coming in. For data protection reasons, it can only be the person that's been the subject to the offence, but they can come in and actually view the interaction that's been recorded. So we've got a number of that. Just two final bits, Chair. I think, first of all, one of the things that we've tried to bring through with the new Kingdom contract has been that principle of added value, and certainly I understand Kingdom have taken part with a number of the partners in a community initiatives event during that first month of operation, working with other partners like residential social landlords and police, etc. And then just one final point I would like to raise, it is a concern that has been highlighted. During that first month, disappointingly, we have had a number of occasions where Kingdom officers on the ground have been the subject of some fairly offensive action from members of the public too. So we've had an occasion where the Kingdom vehicle, we've actually had someone has thrown a large brick, stone type object that has actually come down and gone through the windows of this vehicle. So it's just bearing in mind, and I know as members you absolutely recognise that Kingdom officers are out there on the council's behalf. We're saying to Kingdom that as a council, such behaviour isn't acceptable. We take it very seriously, and we support you all the way. So we will continue to maintain that position, and we are getting publicity out there to make it clear that if we have instances like that, please report them to the police. We take it very seriously, and criminal action will be taken where we can. So that's just a very quick update, Chair, and we'll certainly be here with that real drill down to the general meeting.
Okay, thanks, Mark. Prior to taking questions, can I just ask you, on behalf of everyone, committee, to take our very best wishes back to the individuals involved in that type of assault. That's absolutely unforgivable, the behaviour of that nature.
Thank you, Chair. That would be really appreciated by the people of Kingdom.
I'd like folks involved to know that they have the full support of everyone sat in this room. The second thing, before I take questions, for the January presentation, January meeting, could we ask that the figures that were presented January meeting run at least up to and including the second week in December, so that we have relatively up-to-date information. I fully understand they may well be particularly busy over the December holiday period, but I think given the relevance of some of the comments tonight from the members, I think it's important that the information we have in January is as up-to-date as it possibly can be. So if you could take that back, please. Take questions now. Alan, I'll start with you.
Thank you, Chair. I certainly endorse your comments about the sympathy we extend to the officers who have been subject to inappropriate behaviour. Thank you very much for that report, and obviously we're delighted that they're going to be coming in January, and we'll have an interesting conversation then. But one thing that stood out to me from what you said was there'd be two fines for dog fouling in that month. And we've been rehashing some of the discussion we had at the call-in meeting, but to my mind, this is one of the most significant issues that we get in our postbag as councillors, and the fact that only two people have been fined for such behaviour, it's just not good enough, is it? We really need it. We're not getting on top of that problem at all.
Great, thank you, Alan. Do you want to respond there?
Yeah, just going to say, Chair, I think that's absolutely right. I think obviously that's been one of the influencing factors in making that decision. Now, as we've talked about last time, enforcement of that offence is actually it's quite difficult to do. We went into detail on the graphic signage from last time. But that's one of the key reasons why we are moving towards that plainclothes enforcement, to make sure that we are doing our enforcement as effectively as we can, as we've talked about at length, and getting that behaviour change that's so important.
Thanks, Mark. I have Jerry and then Brian.
Yeah, I just want to say, Tony, I'm just generally unhappy about the whole way it works, but I don't like the idea, Tony, of people sneaking around, and then suddenly talking about people saying, look, adults. Surely our main concern is to people not to do these things. Now, seeing an officer walking around would be a very good way of lesson. But you're suggesting that the main thing that you're there for is to be able to find a safe place. I don't think that's what we should do. I think we should be fine. An officer walking around clearly respecting would be much more successful from the point of view of the public, spirit of the public. You don't want sneaky people jumping out of us. Surely, let's change the policy.
I don't think it's an issue of sneaking around or any inappropriate behaviour that way. It is just that there's issues of how the enforcement action is done, there's issues of proximity, and we are seeing that on the ground these offences are being committed and the dog fouling is still happening. So we are genuinely trying to smarten up the enforcement approach to stop the dog fouling that's happening.
Well, that would be having them with the uniform. They wouldn't do it unless they stop the dog from doing it. But now you're just encouraging people to wait for it. And then you jump up, expose yourself to your permit, and jump out and say, I'm an actor. But that's surely what the people are trying to do. Surely we're not trying to replace you. Surely we're not trying to just raise revenue. Or if we are, tell me. Surely we're trying to stop people doing these things.
I think that's the basis of the contract, Jerry. Just try and encourage behaviour change. I don't think it's there particularly to make money. I think it's there to encourage behaviour change. Brian, you want to know?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. First of all, to thank Mark for his report. And I welcome the report where it said that we're getting the business in January, and I look forward to that. That gives us all an opportunity to ask questions. I think, like Alan, I was a bit concerned when I heard the figure of two, the FPNs, the dog fouling. Anybody looking at that figure might think, well, the problem's all right, there's not a problem anymore. I think everybody in this room knows there's still a problem, and there's somebody going running along with a problem, where you've literally got dodge at sometimes, dog days on the problem, it's just appalling. So I am concerned about that. I look forward to the January meeting, where I would expect a robust report from Kingdom as to what exactly they are doing about dog fouling. I don't share Jerry's view that we're encouraging people to break the law. Far from us. I think we should be encouraging everybody out there to take some responsibility in relation to things like littering, fly tipping, dog fouling, etc. And it's not just about making money. I think we need to make Quill a better place for everybody. So I'm looking forward to the visit in January. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Brian. Adam.
Thanks, Chair. Just got a couple of questions on different areas. Can you just remind me, Mark, of how many challenges we actually had? Because 40% of the challenges have been successful, seem like a high proportion. You said it was, if it's on a small number of challenges, then fair enough. The other point I want to make is, if you remember back to when Kingdom came last time, so not last time we discussed it, but when Kingdom was in it, they showed us a map, like a live map that we might be able to see. Yeah. I'm just wondering whether that's got any further. And then just one final question, just regarding the payments. When a fixed penalty notice is issued, do Kingdom get paid when it's paid, or do the council pay Kingdom for all the fines, even if they're not paid by the
Okay, Chair, I'll try my best to answer those. So, first of all, then, so I'm mindful, obviously, just giving these numbers to you, but it's jotting them down. Yeah. So, of the 380 or 90, there were 49 representations. So, you know, I think it's given us a feel that there's, you know, round about probably between 10-15%. There'll be a representation or a challenge, and then I think it's round about, you know, say 50% of the it's either about 5 or 7% of the total. In relation to that map, I understand that a real positive is that during October we are going to be launching that interactive environmental crime map. So at that presentation, we talked about the idea that there'll be a GIS map that you can zoom on, and you'll be able to see in your area a whole series of environmental statistics around, you know, instances of fly tipping or littering, but also the enforcement activity in the FPNs as well. So that should be going live in the next few weeks. And then just on the final one, I'm just thinking about that in terms of that whole preservation of payment. I probably just need to come back with a response on that, Chair, in terms of the timing of the figures, etc., just to make sure I'm giving an accurate answer on that on the payment issue.
Happy to look back. Now, Steve, Lisa, and Tony.
Yeah, Chair, the first point is about the sort of procedural thing. I think we did say that we would keep a close eye on the contract, so we'll be expecting a further update in November at the November committee, similar to this, and hopefully invite him in advance, so we can look at the figures and pick up them. And then what I would hope that we would get from that next set of figures is members to be able to focus on what they want to really ask and dig down to in November, being proactive again, Tony, about, you know, policy and things going forward again. That's what you can do on speaking. So being proactive about the issue and then, you know, really build out, because from November to January, if we're asking for something really, you know, I don't want Kingdom to come here in January and get a really difficult question saying, oh, I'll come back, it's December. So we may well want to formulate some of our questions as groups and individuals to get in the system early so we get most benefits out of it, because I think what we heard on the calling night, you know, it did disturb many members. But I disagree entirely. We're not there yet. It looks by the figure, some of the figures as though there's less fines, and my view is that the Shangri-La of this contract is that there are no fines because everyone's obeying the law and doing the right thing with either their cigarettes or their dog fowl and what have you. One thing that I am very, very vexed about, I will formulate a question around another issue to come up, but where people maybe, when Kingdom officers are around, pick the dog fowl up in a black bag, tie it, and as soon as the officer's gone, lob over someone's fence or drop in a tree, hang it. Now that, to me, is equally, well, not equally offensive, but it's an offensive. I read a really dangerous article that there's been a number of horses and cattle who have died as a result, because when these bags get thrown over to cattle and horses, the cereal content in dog fowling attracts them, and even the bag and the number of horses have been found, up to 20 bags in the stomach and have died. So my action would be, you know, it's not, I think I'm resonating what other people think. It's all very well putting it in a bag, it's what you do with the bag later. Take it home, put it in your bin, put it in the street bin. That's the message, and I'm hoping Kingdom can do some work on that.
Sure. It's quite strange, just to agree with Steve. There was a program last night where a farmer in Cornwall in Cheshire had to have a footpath moved because his cattle had died from Dunkirk. So, would you like to come away?
Thanks, Andrew. Anita.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Mark, for the report. Two things, really. Jerry, in terms of the enforcement, I'm sorry, I can't agree with you. You know yourself, if you see a policeman with a gun trapping, everybody slows down, start flashing each other, so you know it's a slowdown. But if they are in plain clothes, then that's, and they get fined, it's more likely to encourage behaviour change than, as we just heard, then they might pick the dog more up and then fling the bag, you know, so that's what we're seeing. The question I wanted to ask Mark is that you raised a point about community initiatives, in particular with housing associations. I'm sure as ward councillors, we'd all be keen to know how we could get our own wards involved in such initiatives, if you can share that information with us, please.
Yeah, for you, Chair. We've got a good example of like them that took place. So I've got a note on that, and I'll circulate that down to members. And that's obviously something that I think we'd be encouraging members to get in touch if they'd like to us to do it in a particular area. So I'll circulate the note down with that invitation.
Thank you.
Tony.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, of course, in the interest of ensure the best performance for our residents across the whole of the borough on the contract that's been signed off by Cabinet, and of course that's what we can do on student rather than signing off on the contract for Phil, because that's not within our gift. We need to make sure that we do actually nail down that we do get the best from the contract and the best from Kingdom as the operator. So on the ones that we've actually followed up, the fixed penalty notices that we've followed up, that we've not wiped them off once they've been objected to. How many actually ended up in court, or did they, on the second time of asking, did everyone just pay up, or did we have to go further again, or we not got that far yet?
With them being August, they haven't got that far yet. So that's all I can say. So I'm not sure what the general percentage of those that then ends up going to court is, but we could certainly provide that for the more detail that they wanted.
Just my little bit on that as well is, I suppose, supplementary question to that is, how much does it actually cost us as an authority to get the £80? If we have to go down that route. So I'd be particularly interested in finding out how much those costs are to actually accrue the £80 fixed penalty notice. If and when we do pay up. I mean, that's an important thing for a scrutiny committee to understand that as well.
I think for reassurance, and Karen will chip in as well, I think when we're taking legal action, taking people to court, if they rule in our favour, they award costs against the defendant, so we're recovering all of our costs of going through that legal process.
That's that. Yes, clearly it's a different ballgame when you actually have to take matters through the court process, and because of the cost implications, and not only just information to Mark's sector, but also legal cost applications are double effectively the fixed penalty, which is worth £450 per application, and of course that's then within the remit of the court to either grant that, or if individuals do attend, use their discretion to reduce that figure. It's within the discretion of the court to award the level of costs that the
property to obtain.
Tony, and then Adam.
Thanks, Chair. At the last scrutiny committee, we were asked to mention some hot spots, and you know, it would be positive on one of them. I did mention there was a big improvement in Dock Fowling in Oxford and that, and I think that has continued. Where it hasn't improved whatsoever is around the lake in West Carrabee, and I mentioned this at the last scrutiny. It's actually got a lot worse. And I was stopped, certainly over the summer holidays, by quite a number of people who were saying, look, why are people around it? I don't think they knew I was a councillor or anything like that. And when we had visitors and walked around, it was very similar. So, you know, I don't think really, you know, when I see there was only two penalty notices, you know, for that, and I go along with Brian. And if you go down to New Brighton, it's likewise the same, because you can walk from Seacombe to down to New Brighton and have to run the prom. It is really bad. So, you know, I would just say, you know, the Sea Kingdom are doing a decent job, but please certainly look around one of our places where we have a lot of visitors during summer and all throughout the year. Both New Brighton and West Carrabee.
Okay, thanks, Tony. I think that's very relevant, and I think for us as scrutiny committee, if we give our intelligence to all councillors of that nature, I think it's beholden on us to feed it into the system somehow. And I'm more than happy to take any emails with intelligence like that and pass them on, because I think that's very, very relevant. Thanks for that, Tony. Adam.
Just to pick up on those core costs, I think when he's been explaining that maybe we don't get all our core costs back, so it would be interesting still to think to have the figures of how many go to court and also how many we lose as well, because, you know, when they go to court will not be successful.
Yeah. Well, can I just answer that point? Yes, the issue is that when we do go to court, we tend to seek a set fee of £150 costs, for example. Now, if individuals respond and indicate their financial means, the courts have a duty to consider a financial penalty in light of those means. So on some occasions, the application for costs should be costs would be reduced to take into account debt finances. That happens on a number of cases, but not in all cases.
Okay, any more questions on that particular item? Item 6? No? In that case, we move on to item 7 then. Vote. Everyone knows the report, and we're all happy for the more in-depth drilling down report and presentation in January.
Yeah?
And the briefing note or the updating note back then.
I think Steve was right. I've got forward some questions before the obstacle and
Yeah,
so it makes sense that because otherwise they have to go away again, like just the next round talk about it, and then come back again.
Okay, thanks for that. So I'm happy to move on then to item 7. Little Flood and Water Risk Management Partnership. Terms of reference, pages 57 to 66 in your paperwork. I'll invite Mark to make his presentation.
Okay, thank you, Chair. So, as the report outlines, the Wirral Flood and Water Management Partnership was set up in 2009 in response to the PIP review. The main purpose of the partnership is to achieve, through joint working, and effective management of flooding and coastal erosion into the Tweed Wirral, and is to take such collective measures in order to minimise the potential impact of such incidents, and to see the implementation of more permanent sustainable solutions to mitigate and alleviate flooding and coastal erosion. So what we've got here is we've got a revised terms of reference, Chair, for this Wirral Flood and Water Management Partnership, and the aim is to establish that formal link with the overview and scrutiny function. And the members here of that committee to make sure that we provide an appropriate governance and member oversight on all such matters. So the detailed terms of reference are attached from page 64. On page 64 at the bottom, you'll see the list of the partners on that partnership. You'll see there that we've got strong local council representation with a chair, but then suggesting that we have a nomination from you know, from each party, you know, a representation on the partnership group, if members think appropriate. And that's the opportunity where we do get that wide range of other key partners, such as United Utilities and the Environment Agency, you know, round the table on such matters. So I think really, Chair, we're just looking for, hopefully members will all support the appropriate comments on the terms of reference we've got, and hopefully it seems a sensible way forward. If, as members, you think it is, obviously the members will be to nominate representatives onto the group. And I think what we then look to do, so talking to Neil Thomas, who's our lead flood and coastal risk manager, I think his view was that if members are inclined to support this, we look to get the first meeting of the group established pretty shortly. I'm sure that looking out the window this evening, Chair, obviously we've seen there's a lot of rain and flooding issues very live as we speak. So we'd look to get that first meeting in the diary pretty quickly. And when I talk to Neil, this is quite a complex, sizable agenda. So I think we'd be suggesting that for the first meeting, certainly Neil would come along with all of that technical expertise and give a proper detailed presentation, really, to, you know, explain the background, go through what came out of the paper review, really to speed up members up to speed on that. And talk about some of the recent incidents that we've had on the world with flooding that members will be aware of, and how we've responded to that over the past few years. Happy to take any questions.
Yeah. Thanks, Mark. Does anyone have any questions?
Yeah.
Christina.
Very quick. Could you tell me who the interim director of highways and streets in the group?
That's me, Chair.
But aren't you also strategic commissioner?
That's actually my substantive role. I'm still picking up this function, supporting this committee, but I am in an interim role in delivery services.
Thank you, Mark.
Do we have any other questions? Bruce.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I'd just like to know how many meetings a year in good business take place.
Yeah, through you, Chair, I think Neil's suggestion was that it was typically two or three members.
Very good question.
Do we have any more? Do we have any more questions? Any more questions? Okay, I have a suggestion. Given the fact that myself and the party spokes set the agendas, agenda set of meetings, and have what I'd like to think is a reasonably good working relationship, would be my suggestion that the three representatives from this committee, unless someone did it greatly, be the chair and party spokesman. That will be my recommendation. I'd like to think that would garner some support. So everybody's happy with that then, yeah?
Yeah.
Unanimously happy?
Yes.
Thank you. Just before we move off that agenda item, then everyone's happy to accept the revised terms of reference. Thank you. That brings us to item 8. Can I inform members that the work programme planning session has agreed to undertake task and finish review on recycling. For the benefit of new members, it was agreed that a presentation will be delivered to members to give an overview of where we currently are as a local authority, as well as identify what could be covered in the review. And to that end, we have Claire Brown, who is going to do a presentation. Claire, can I start with an apology? Sorry we kept you waiting so long. Nice to see you and thank you for your presentation.
Thank you very much, Chair. Good evening, members. Thank you for inviting me to come and talk to you about something. So, I've been asked to come and give you an overview of what we do on the Wirral, why we do it, our current position, and sort of future challenges that we will be facing in the future. So just to start with, when we talk about Wirral's recycling, when we talk about Wirral's recycling rate, we're actually talking about household waste and only household waste. We have a statutory function to collect household waste, and it's the controlled waste regulations that actually set out what is classed as household waste. So that includes things like everything from residential properties, so your green bin, your grey bin, brown and bulky waste, waste collected from schools, anything from green banks, and we also have street cleaning and sweeping. Commercial waste is not included in recycling rates. So if we do it, the only trade waste collection that we actually do at the moment is council buildings, but any recycling that we do through that isn't actually counted as the council's recycling rate. So say it's all recycling, composting, and any reuse that we do. So currently the national reuse and recycling target is 50% by 2020. So we are a waste collection authority, and we're part of a two-tier authority. So our collected waste is consigned to a disposal authority, who are the Merseyside Recycling and Waste Authority, or Mr. Waugh, as we like to call them. So all of the Merseyside districts excepting St. Helens entered into a contract with the MRWA regarding what materials we would collect commingled in our recycling bins. This was back in 2004-2005, before the materials recovery facility was even built. So you can see, I mean, already obviously in the years that have followed, things have changed in recycling capabilities. But back then, the agreement was that we would collect paper, cardboard, plastic bottles, glass bottles and jars, and metal cans and tins. So that doesn't include aerosol cans, doesn't include foil, no other plastics, and no cartons. To change that, to add any additional materials, would it require a variation to that contract, and it would also require changes to the sorting facility, which is designed to separate out the five streams that we currently have. So the highest recycling performance that we've ever had was 2011-12, and it was 40.6%. Garden Waste Subscription Service was brought in June 2013, and the first full year recycling rate that we had after that was reduced to 36%. It's decreased slightly over the years since then, but last year we actually had quite a large decrease, and 2017-18 it's currently showing 33.2%. So just a graph there that shows the national average. National average, you see, has also slightly decreased, but ours has been decreasing much more rapidly. Looking at the past 5 years of waste data, so trying to see where that decrease has come from, our collected recycling has actually only decreased very slightly. So what is actually collected in the green grey bins on the curbside has reduced, but not that much. However, this year, what's had the massive drop this year has actually been because of rejected waste at the recovery facility in Bidston. So what is collected in the grey bin and goes to recovery facility is sorted out, and then anything that isn't sorted into those five categories is classed as residual waste, and that, let's say, has increased by 8% over the past year. We think that that is because the plant actually went through a bit of a modernisation about 18 months ago to improve the quality of the materials that we are collecting and improve the quality of the materials that are going to the reprocessors. So possibly it's actually masking a historical issue that we've always had this amount of contamination, we just now are better able at to remove that. This plant modernisation was brought in due to the quality requirements from reprocessors becoming much, much, much more stringent. So, for example, the paper market requires a quality of 98.5% pure paper. So, a nappy that ends up in there means that whole bale of paper is rejected because it's contaminated. They put in the new facilities to try and improve mostly the paper quality that was coming out. On average, we collect about 13,000 tonnes of garden waste every single year. That has remained quite steady since the subscription was introduced. Prior to that, we were collecting about 18,000 tonnes per year. It fluctuates slightly each year due to the weather, but this year our garden waste actually isn't going to be that great because we didn't have enough rain to have a nice growing season. So the amount that we actually collect has reduced. And the other thing that's taken a hit over the past 5 years is the bring bank collections because, A, people now have a grey bin at the property, hopefully, and textile collections, the price for textiles aren't as high, so they've gone down. Over the 5 years, we've actually reduced our tonnages that we're collecting in the bin bring banks by 600 tonnes a year. Just to give you an idea of what's happening nationally and how we compare. So it's not just the Wirral that have been seeing a decrease in our dry recycling, so our grey bin recycling tonnages. Last year, 60% of councils actually saw a reduction in their dry recycling. Traditionally, we've actually been really good at our dry recycling. We've been higher than average when it comes to the amount of paper, glass, cans, cardboard. However, this year it's actually brought us below the national average. We're the blue line, and we've been above national average until last year. The difference in our recycling rate to other top performing councils is actually because of how much garden waste we collect. The national average currently for composting and food treatment is 21.1%. Our current composting rate is 11.47%. Even when it was there was no subscription and our service was free, the maximum percentage of recycling that we had that's for garden waste was only 15.28%. So even at our highest, we were nowhere near the national average. Now the difference is food. The councils that collect food, also there's a lot of councils that have more gardens than we do, much greener. So those councils, and so the councils that do food, do have a higher recycling rate because they've got more garden waste. Wirral Council did separate food collection, it would add about 8% to our recycling rate. However, when we looked into that, there was that it was very expensive because we forced it to be an issue with that. Looking forward, the government announced last week that they are in the final stages of their development of a new resources and waste strategy. They're hoping to release it late in November after the budget. And they announced that the strategy will have five pillars to it, five areas. So, looking very far into the future, becoming a zero avoidable waste economy by 2050. Phasing out avoidable plastic waste by 2042. This is one that's really going to impact us. Our new targets for waste and recycling, which will be coming in at least at these levels, because these are what have been agreed as part of the EU circular economy package. It's 55% recycling by 2025, 60% recycling by 2030, 65% recycling by 2035. They're also suggesting that they will be stopping food waste going to landfill by 2030, and they're looking at reforming the packaging recovery note scheme, which is the producer responsibility, putting a bit more responsibility on the producers of the waste. So, to try and halt this decrease is we've implemented a waste management improvement plan. So this year we've been offering free grey recycling bins, which has been funded through the Waste Development Fund. So, I mean, obviously, the best thing you can do to help somebody recycle is give them a recycle bin. So we've offered them for free, and actually the number of recycling bins that have been delivered has increased quite substantially. We're currently looking at the green residual waste bins, so trying to take any unauthorised additional green bin off the street. We're currently doing an audit of all of those properties, it's about 4,000 that are currently actually authorised to have an additional bin, but they haven't. In some cases they haven't actually had a visit or a review of that bin for about 5 years, so their circumstances could have changed. And then we're going to be implementing an audit for any new request that comes in. And when I say audit, I mean we're going to go out, make sure they've got a recycle bin, and make sure that we can give them as much help and support in using that recycling facility as best as possible before we say, yes, here you go, here's another bin. We're also going to be running some targeted campaigns, initially concentrating on our 10 lowest recycling rounds. So that's looking at the tonnages of waste that we collect in the green bins against the tonnages of the waste that we collect in the recycling bins. And those that are recycling the least will be going out, doing some door knocking, using behavioural insights tools to try and make sure that we are getting the right message to the people that need that message, giving them the support that they need to try and encourage recycling in those rounds. The improvement plan is only going to halt any further decrease. At best, it will bring us back up to where we were. But we carry out, or the MRWA carries out, waste compositional analysis every 5 years. The last one was carried out in 2015-2016. And from that, the maximum amount of recycling that we can do from the curbside is 42.4%. So that is taking into account, if everybody recycled everything that they could do, our recycling rate would be 42.4. We also then have potentially another 4% that comes from our recycling from street sweepings and green bags and everything. But even then, that's 46% is our maximum currently. If we were to add in cartons, aerosols, other plastics, the things that we would all love to be able to recycle, that actually only gives us an extra 2.3% on our recycling rate. If we were to add food into our collections, that brings us up to 69.7%, because our total waste stream collected at the curbside, food actually makes up 25% of that. So I'm just giving you a little bit of an arch of the possible of how we could or would possibly meet our recycling targets in 2025 and 2030. I think 2020 is a little bit of a stretch. But those are the other thing obviously to consider is looking at how we help people produce less waste in the first place. And so looking down the waste hierarchy, waste prevention is the top thing that would help. But then recycling or reuse and recycling. But say just to give you a little flavour of what's possible. Well, thank you very much.